So just by way of introduction to everyone, I'm Maddie Lachey. I work at the University of Utah. I'm the executive director for simulation in the College of Nursing. So I help out with this because we also have this intern product. So I help teach these. So you can ask me whatever. I write all the simulations and the clinical assignments for all of our instructors, and I create all the folders. So if you have any questions as we go, anything to do with even teaching and faculty and how this is used for your, or going to be used for your programs, just let me know. Just interrupt and ask away. I'm really good with that. So I have, hopefully you guys are logged in. Fran's looking into it if it's slow because of the running the video program or if it's running slow this morning. We can't quite decide which one it is, but what I'm going to do for this course is share my screen, and then I'll walk you through. You'll be able to hear me, and I'll walk you through the basic training, but of course this is specific to your school, so you can ask anything. We can change it up a bit if there's something you have in mind to use specifically for your courses. You can ask me that in detail, and we'll get into it for as long as we have for the 2 hours. And also I am going to pull up my stuff so I can show you my course from our university if you want to see that towards the end and kind of see how I've organized stuff, if that would be helpful.
Yes.
Okay, great. So let me try sharing my screen. I haven't used the Zoom thing before, but here we go. I'm gonna do it. Share screen. All right. Okay, are you guys able to see this screen right here? Can you see my mouse?
Yes.
Okay, it worked. I can't see it on my screen, so you tell me if you don't see something. Okay, I'm already logged in. Are you guys already logged into this training course?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So you know how to get in, and when you do your own course, you guys have your own course yet?
Maddie, just so you know, I hid the pictures of the people so that way they were showing up in front of your screen so they can't currently see an image of you because I wanted them to see the whole tutoring screen.
Oh, that's just fine. That's perfect. Okay. Not a problem. You don't need to see me. I feel much better that you can't. No.
Well, just in case you were doing hand gestures or anything.
Oh, I'm doing hand gestures, but you won't see them. It's fine. I talk with my hands anyway. Okay, perfect. So you can see the whole screen. My question was, did you guys already have your own course set up on Evolve?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, so first thing you need to know is, and maybe you already do, that you can click on the title. Do you see where I'm moving my cursor back and forth here? You can always click on the title and change the name of your course to whatever matches your program. So, for example, some people purchase the program so that the cohort of students have it for the entire cohort. So we'll name, for example, the course, the name of the student cohort, and they'll just follow it through. And then every folder we have in SimChart will be named for the course they're in, if that makes sense. The other thing you need to know, as soon as you click out, if you rename it, it'll start saving it. The other thing you need to know is your course ID. So right underneath here is a course ID. That is what's going to help you share assignments back and forth. For example, let's say you called me up and said, hey, Maddie, do you have an assignment for maternity? Let me look at it. Do you mind sharing that with me, the one you made? And I say, sure, let me have your course ID. So then this is the number, the name, and those last four numbers that you need to tell me or use to share assignments back and forth. So the reason why that's important is because if you're using the same assignments for future courses, say the next cohort of students come on and they also purchase SimChart, you will be able to share the assignments you've already created if you made some favorite ones yourself from one course to the next without having to recreate it. So those two things you just need to know about. You can change the name, and you need to know your course ID for several things, especially for sharing assignments. Okay, there's a few other really good things to know before we get into the nuts and bolts, and that is number one up here. I have it highlighted, instructor resources. Do you see that? Mm-hmm. Instructor resources will have all the information we go over today. And it will have all the information on how to create assignments, how to share assignments. There's training videos within there. Have you guys played around inside the instructor resources yet?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So I won't spend a ton of time on that. There are student resources. Have you guys looked at the student resources also? Mm-hmm. So in the student resources, I'd just like to highlight that there is a training course video for the students to watch. That is a good one. So what I do is when I have a new cohort of students come on, instead of spending a lot of their classroom time and orientation time going over how to chart, I have them do the, in student resources, I have them do the orientation video before they even come to class. So that way I know they're at least familiar with it.
I can cover that with them too at orientation.
And I've even created my own little assignment for the students that they have to go in and they can follow step by step on how to do their, get into the video and watch the video before they come to class. And then I just have the expectation that they'll know how to do certain things in SimChart before they come. And of course, not all of them will do it, but that's the expectation. That makes it a little bit easier than to have somebody that has to come in and spend an hour to 2 hours of class time doing training for the students. But I'll tell you right now, they'll get used to it much faster than you will. So my experience is my faculty who've now been using it for 2 years, you know who you are, who are not computer savvy, are still struggling to grade assignments while the students completely know how to do it from like after week one. So here's my advice to whoever our administrator is in the room. I would definitely designate one person who you know is computer savvy that you can give them some time on their contract that can make assignments. You will save a lot of headache. It doesn't matter which program you purchase. It doesn't matter what electronic health record you use. I've used them all. One person who knows the computer probably should try to make the assignments. And then I have all the other faculty, they just grade. So I think that just cuts down on confusion for those that aren't that great at the computer. And we all have some people who are not. So, okay. So those are the couple of little things I just wanted to get you to know right off the bat. Again, you can ask me anything, any tips, any tricks. I'm not hired by Elsevier, so you can just go ahead and ask away. Okay, so first we're going to look at my clinicals. Are you planning on using SimChart for the clinical experience charting?
Yes.
Great, perfect. So we've added that into both fundamentals and our MedSearch course. Under my clinicals, you see that first one? My clinicals is where they would see their clinical assignments. The next folder underneath that, right here where I have my cursor, is case studies. That I use for a lot of classroom, but you can use it for multiple things, and I can tell you a little bit about that, but that's kind of the next course to take on how to make case studies. However, I use them a lot. And then the last one here is simulations, and that's creating like a simulation electronic health record chart that the student can look at before they come to SIM so they can learn about the patient. And then when they get to simulation, they can chart in the electronic health record. So you have three types of assignments you can do. Another important thing to look at down below, there's a practice assignment, My Clinical, a practice assignment case study, and a practice assignment simulation. What happens with the students every single time, I guarantee you, and it happens with us every single time, is they will go into their clinical assignment or their case study assignment thinking that they can just play around with it and kind of figure out how to use it before they actually do their assignment. Well, it doesn't work that way, right? So they go into their assignment, it's charting their assignment. So make sure to point out that there's these practice assignments down here that the students can play around with before, so they feel comfortable before they get into their real assignment for the class. That just saves a little bit of anxiety for those high performers. I found that our 4.0 students are high performers. They want to just get in there and play and know everything before they do the assignment. So point out this practice assignment down here. Okay, so those are your three types of assignments. That's where the assignments will be housed on the Evolve platform. We are not actually into the SimChart program yet. Obviously, we're on the Evolve platform. So on the Evolve platform is where they have all of these folders for all the assignments within the course. So just like, I don't know if you guys use Blackboard or any of those kind of platforms, it works just like that. So that's the Evolve platform. To go into the SimChart program and create an assignment, you will always use SimChart Setup. You see that right there? So a clue for you is anything in the brown or orange, however you can see it, I think it's an orange color for you. Instructor Resources, SimChart Setup, SimChart Training Modules, which have a lot of modules you can look at to learn how to do things. All of these in orange, only the instructors can see. So anyone you have in your course as an instructor can see these orange folders. The students can only see the blue folders. So that'll help you remember that if you're going to create an assignment, you always want to go into SimChart Setup. A lot of times people want to go into the folder that holds the assignments to make an assignment. Every assignment is made in SimChart Setup, okay? So I'll repeat myself several times on purpose, right? Research says we have to repeat ourselves 5 to 7 times for us to remember. So don't get annoyed. I will repeat myself on purpose. So the first thing you want to know is how to create an assignment for my clinicals. My students are going into clinical week 1. What were you going to click on?
SimChart Setup.
That's right. SimChart Setup. So that's where we're going to create all the assignments. So if we click on SimChart Setup, let's wait our obligatory, I don't know how long and what's going on, but I think the video, I don't know about you, but when my kids are playing video games, it takes all the bandwidth in my house and my computer doesn't work. So I'm kind of wondering if that's what's going on.
I think it's Elsevier because we're having it and none of the faculty here are running video.
Oh, okay. Okay, good. All right. Well, then that makes me feel better than if they get this going, then it might pick up. Okay. So you notice how now I have an open tab at the top of my computer. Can you guys see the tabs at the top?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So now I'm in the SimChart program. It opened up a new tab for me. The Evolve platform is still here when I click on the tab. Do you see that? And I click back over to my SimChart tab. This SimChart Setup opened up in a new tab or a new window, depending on how you have your browser set up. So it'll be a tab or a window. In the SimChart Setup piece, you will see a bunch of tabs across the top. So if you think of these as like, this is a big file folder, and here's the tabs of your files, like your paper files, then you can see how you can go into multiple different places to do to create assignments. So that's kind of how I think of it, kind of the old-fashioned way, is this is a tab, this is a folder, this is a folder, this is a folder under each tab. So automatically, what it came up to when I clicked on SimChart Setup was my clinical assignments, to create my clinical assignments. So I'm in this clinicals tab, and it's allowing me to create an assignment in my clinicals folder. So these assignments, the basic idea for my clinical assignment is that the student will be able to put in their own patient information that they have at the clinical setting. So it's basically an open chart. To create these assignments, it's really easy. You're not putting in background information about patients. You're not putting in anything. You're basically just titling the assignment, and that's it. Super easy to create. The more difficult assignments to create, of course, are case studies, because you're going to add in all the information and simulations to put in all past electronic, fake, pretend health record information that you would have for a pretend patient or a simulated patient. But for clinicals, it's just an open chart. So as you can see, though, if you don't have time and you want to use this for simulation and you're like, you know what, I just want to use it, I just want it to be up so the students can chart, you can always use my clinicals for any other assignment. It doesn't have to be just for clinicals. And I go back and forth on the way I use the different assignments myself. But just keep in mind, my clinical assignment, really quick, you just title it and you publish it and it's done. So at the top, you can see the first field for clinical setup is the assignment title. Whatever you want it to be called, you're not going to name it a patient or anything because every student in the clinical will have a different patient. Unless you're using this assignment for something else, then you could. I like to just say, for example, week one, or maybe you guys call them module one. Each assignment is for one patient. Okay, so keep that in mind. If you want the student to take two patients in clinical, then you need two assignments, right? One electronic health record for each patient. So first of all, I like to just say week one, patient one. If you just require your students just to take one patient, say they're in fundamentals and they're just taking one patient, then you don't need to do the patient one. But just FYI, make sure that you know when you're doing these assignments in clinical, one assignment equals one electronic health record for one patient, okay? So I just named this assignment week one, patient one. Then you can put in your assignment objective. So we do our accreditation with AACN, so I like to put in the clinical course objectives that I'm trying to match that have to do with charting. So that, you know, when I get around to accreditation again, I have it right there. I just pull it up. I show them, here you go. Here's my objectives. Here's the course objectives. They match the clinical objectives for the assignment. And then, really great down here, if you're really ambitious too, which I've been trying to be this year, you can add in your quality and safety QCN education goals. You can add in competencies for NCLEX-RN, national patient safety goals, or you can put in custom competencies. So this is where I also like to map it to the, not just the course objectives up here, but kind of map it to the semester outcomes and then the whole program outcomes. So I have a nice little map for every assignment. I love it. It's done. I'm done. Whenever accreditation comes, I can just pull it up. So that's just something to keep in mind while you're making assignments. You might as well throw that stuff in and your life is easier later. All that is required though to create this assignment is just the title. That's all is required. So you can put in the objectives, you can put in competencies. All it is a click the box to put in a competency and that's fine. But you don't have to. So all it really needs is just the title. Okay, so then at the very, very bottom of the screen is publish. So when you click on publish, it brings up a pop-up box. It has who is publishing this assignment, and it will let you confirm your email address. So what this means is if I were to copy, you see, I'm just right-clicking and copying and pasting my email address. If I copy and paste my email address and hit submit, every time a student finishes an assignment, I will get an email that they completed it. So personally, my personal preference is I hate all the emails completely and utterly, and I grade assignments when I grade them. So I like to click this little email out opt-out button. So if you do email opt out, then you will not get an email notification of the assignments. So that's just completely up to you. So if you're the type that likes to grade on the fly as soon as the assignment is completed, you run in there and grade it, great. If not, and your email is as full as mine is, then you might want to click the email opt out button. All right, I'm going to go backwards because like I said, I repeat myself a lot. Okay, so what did we do? We logged into our Evolve account. I wanted to create a My Clinicals assignment. I clicked on Sim Chart Setup. It pulled up a window or a tab for Sim Chart. It automatically put me into a My Clinical assignment. I named the assignment. I put in objectives. I clicked on my competencies for that assignment. Then I clicked Publish at the very bottom. I did the email opt-out because I did not want to be notified when students finish their assignments. And then finally, I'm going to click submit. So that's it. That's how you create a My Clinical Assignment. You go into SimChart. You click on SimChart Setup. You put in a title and you click Submit. It's very easy. And you, for the faculty side, in creating the My Clinical Assignment, you're done. So I'm sitting here in oblivion. I don't know about you guys. Did you guys try it?
Yeah.
Yes.
It might be that we're all in the same course. I don't know. Let's see.
Matt, can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Suppose we set that assignment up and then want to edit it. Is that a possibility?
No, it's not. And I'll tell you why. Because there's nothing to edit. All you did was title it. So you would just delete it and put in a new title. There's nothing to edit in this type of an assignment.
Okay.
All you did was create a title. If you don't like the title, delete it and put a new title. So what I'm waiting for, because it's an internet program, is this OK button. You see now my OK, it's published. It took 25 years, which it normally does not, or it just felt like 25 years. I'm a clicker. I like to click around fast. So now I know it published and I hit OK. So that's very important. We put that on your little notes, a little asterisk by it, that your assignment did not publish unless you get that OK box. All right. It's an internet program. So you want to make sure you're in your office on a computer that's wired in when you're playing with the internet, not at the coffee shop, right? And that's the same thing I tell the students. I do not allow the excuse that my internet went down or I clicked it or whatever. I say it's an internet program. If you're doing your assignment, you shouldn't be at the internet cafe, at the coffee shop where the internet, you know, is really bad and in and out, because things won't get saved. So I like to remind them to be at a computer that's hardwired in, not doing Wi-Fi when they're trying to do their assignment. And I kind of do that myself. Matt, yes?
Where would we go to see if it's published? Where would you see it? Like, if you wanted to look?
Good question. Okay. So I would go back to the Evolve platform. So where do you guess that assignment will show up?
My Clinical Students.
Exactly. Yep. Under My Clinicals. So I would get out of my setup and back into the Evolve platform. And then a lot of times you want to hit refresh, right? Because we're on the internet, just to make sure that you can see everything pop up. And then you would hit whatever type of assignment you created. What was your question? I'm sorry if I said something.
No. Well, you answered it. Where would we find it?
Where would you find it?
No, I think you answered it.
Oh, okay. Good. So we're going to go there right now, though. So you click on My Clinicals. And this will, it's published, meaning the student will see it and you will see it both. When you click on My Clinicals, you'll see the assignment in the folder. And I guess we'll wait our time for it to pop up. Okay, so another thing I wanted to let you guys know, when you are in the assignment, and now it's blank. When you're in Evolve, maybe I should hit refresh. I don't know. Oh, it's painfully slow today. It's hurting my soul. You can usually click through super fast. But when you're in the Evolve platform, do not rename any of those folders that were down here that say My Clinicals and stuff. So if you're a computer savvy type person and you want to name your folders different things, don't do it, because when I was in that SimChart program, it automatically is tied to the name of that folder, and that's where it put my assignment. So if you rename that folder, it won't be able to find where to publish the assignment. That's just a little FYI. For those of you that like to play on the computer and are really good with it. Okay, here we are. So looks like whoever set this playground up, or maybe you guys were already doing it, playing in here. Oh, you guys all probably published your own assignment, huh? So here's at the very top, the one, week one, patient one, clinical one, patient one. Looks like everybody had different things they wanted to name it. Your assignment will automatically show up right there. So we have a whole bunch of assignments because all of us created one. When you go into the assignment, you'll notice, well, I want to show you this too. See how there's a little picture of a box right here? I don't know why it's a box picture, but that means it's an assignment. You can also create folders. So when I said that if you want to name this course up here for a whole cohort, and then just make folders for each course, you know, that they're in, right here in Evolve, you have to be in Evolve, not in SimChart. In Evolve, you can create folders. Painfully slowly, apparently. In here, if you click Add Content, you can create a folder. And then you can put your assignment, you can name that folder, say, Fundamentals Course. And then you can put that assignment in Fundamentals so that the students, you know, can follow from course to course. So when they go into their next semester, it might be Med-Surg or whatever you have for second semester. Yeah.
All of your students
Mary, I have a question.
But so we're going to get into that cohort thing in 102, 103, 104. Mm-hmm. Can we each make our own? Like, so my folder's only 103 assignments?
Sure. Right, Maddie, they can each make their own and name any folder they want for their particular assignment.
Absolutely. So you can have, and like I said, I do all the assignments for everyone. So our instructors, they just go in and look for their course. Would they go into the same, for example, cohort, our cohort, we name them by their admission. So say we had spring 2016 cohort was the name of the Evolve course. And then when they go in, it says nurse, you know, 4315 fundamentals is the name of the folder. And all the students know that they're in that course, and that course, that's where they look for their assignments.
Hey, Maddie.
Yeah.
I have a question. So we have one course for all of us. So every time I'm adding something, everyone can see it. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So we would have to make the folders then to keep it all separate, or we're going to not know where everybody's clinical stuff is.
Absolutely. I mean, you can have multiple courses, but that gets really confusing. I mean, that's a lot to have on your Evolve. I would just do one course and then folders for each class.
Okay, then I have another question, sorry. Okay, yes. So then at the end of this semester, is this all purged? Because we don't want all that stuff in there. Like if these are clinical assignments from semester to semester.
So I'll show you if this wants to cooperate. I'm gonna go into my course so I can show you what I mean. Would that help you guys?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Okay, I'll show you what I mean. So bear with me. Go.
Some students that are dying the six-month break, some that are doing the 18 months, some that are doing 2 years. So how should we do that? Well, let's see what Maddie shows us in hers. Maddie, the question is that they have all of the students, so they have a two-year course shell. Students are purchasing multiple length access codes. So some are getting a 2-year code, some are getting 6 months, some are getting 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
And I hear what you're saying about setting up just one course folder, but if they want to set things up for these, you know, for students who are at different places in the program, what's the best way to do that? I mean,
I would do it by cohort.
For example,
if you're buying a 6-month access because one group of students will be done in a year, there'll be a course for that whole cohort for the rest of their time in nursing school.
Okay, when you say cohort, are you meaning separate shells? Give them a 6-month shell, give them an 18-month shell, and give them a 2-year shell? Or are you talking creating a cohort folder within this course shell?
No, other way. I'm talking about a SimChart course, like with the whole course ID.
Okay.
A whole thing for each cohort. And then all the classes they have throughout their entire nursing program are in that one course.
So I'm gonna talk to the faculty for 1 second, sorry.
No, you're fine, go ahead. It's obviously gonna be a minute.
Okay, all right. So right now we've opened a 2-year shell for you because any student coming in and starting it in 100 this fall,
right,
they need an entire 2 years.
But they remember we set it up so they're going to have 6 months just in case.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
They fail out.
That's right.
So they don't have a 2-year contract.
That's right. So they will still enroll into that 2-year shop. Fires, then they're just going to buy 18 months and keep
right.
going in that same shop.
Okay.
But for students who are later in the program, let's say they've only bought a 6-month ID because they only need 6 months to get them through. I don't think anyone needed just 6. I think they're 12-month and 18-month,
right?
We can open 2 additional shelves so that one is just an 18-month shell, one is just a 12-month shell. And then those students who buy those particular access codes are just enrolling into those shelves.
So do we have to post the assignments 3 times?
That's the thing, right, Maddie? So then you can create, and they can create the assignment in one shell and then copy and paste to the other 2 shells, correct, Maddie?
Absolutely. That was why I said look at that course ID. You just use that ID, and all I do is when the new cohort comes in, so I have a cohort that starts in fall and a cohort that starts in spring, I create the whole fall course, and then I just copy my assignments to my spring course.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Okay. Does that make sense?
It
doesn't look like you're happy about that, though.
I'm just nervous about cohorts. We don't have to keep track of students and numbers and all of that, right? Like we had to with the HESI stuff.
No.
Is that just gets so confusing?
No, they're just going to enroll and be in just.
No, they enroll themselves. It's the I don't. They do it themselves. They enroll into the course and they're in for 2 years. That's it.
Or 6 months, whatever.
Or 6 months or whatever.
Okay, so I just for clarification purposes. So what you're looking at here are these little. These are considered shells.
That's correct.
So what you're going to have is say 3 different shells for whatever cohort of students. So the instructor may have to go in and replicate 3 times what they did. That seems...
No, you don't have to replicate. You just copy it. It'll copy and you can copy it to the next course.
So you're going to have to cut...
Copy in.
No, you don't copy paste. I'll show you. You just share it with one course. You just send your assignment to the other course.
All right. I think that's something we're definitely going to want to see today before
Hopefully, yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah.
Yes, you'll see that.
But I mean, it's simple to make these things available in all 3 shells.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So what I do is I have my play course that I create my assignments in, edit them, and then I share it when I have it just the way I want it. I share it to the course I'm putting it in.
Okay.
So for example, last year's course, I'm in there editing stuff I didn't like the way the assignment was. So I'll edit it there until I get it what I want. And then I'll share it with my new course. I'll just send it over to the new course.
Okay, good. We're going to want to see how easy that is.
It is, but apparently I can't get in right now.
Question then.
Yes.
I'm not a faculty member. I'm their IT support, so they can yell at me if this doesn't ever happen. But say, for instance, a student is in cohort 1.
Right.
They now fail one of their classes in that cohort, and they are now taking the class with cohort 2 because you have to repeat the class.
Right.
How do they get to see that information? Because they are in the first cohort, not the second cohort.
So what I'll do is I'll go into right here where it says rosters and teams.
Okay.
And I'll unenroll them from one course. And then I'll call my person at Elsevier and say, I'm taking one of these kids off this course and I'm putting them on the other course. You need to open another number for me. I'm moving them from one to the other. And they'll give you an access code and you can just add them to the other course.
So they can stay within that same cohort, but they can move from one class from a cohort to another class in another cohort.
Right. And ideally, you know, unless you edited everything, which does happen. I mean, it's happening to me right now. Ideally, it's usually about the same stuff anyway. But yeah, you can add them to the other cohort. If you want them to see both, then you'll have to call and let them know they failed a class and you want to open it in the other cohort too. So I'll have to give you an access code to get the other student in the other class.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're in my class now. You see how it says up here, SIM chart? I name it SIM chart because the students get confused. So SIM chart, spring 2016 cohort. So this is the class that came in on spring 2016. This one has a one-year access. This is my course ID. So it's the M. Lachey. And when they go into any of their folders, for example, my clinicals. They go into my clinicals, you'll see the folder. So I named the class what cohort they are. So here's their first semester. See how it says, I put it at the bottom because now they're not in first semester anymore. They're in second over summer. Here's our second semester. So ours is first semester clinical. I named it down here. I added this folder. See how it's not a box, it's a folder now. And I named it Nurse 3315, the exact name of their class. Nurse 3315, Maternal Infant Health Nursing. So they had my clinicals at for their first semester for OB, and that's that class. And then in second semester, they have clinicals for Nurse 3410, Acute Care Nurse Practicum. So they can see their first semester clinical and their second semester clinical when they look at it. If I go into case studies, you'll see some more. So I use case studies for fundamentals because we here at the University of Utah, they have all of their fundamentals class in our simulation lab. So I didn't use my clinicals. I used case studies. So you'll see how they had first semester Nurse 3305 Foundations of Clinical Care. That's our fundamentals. And then they have Nurse 3315, the OB course. Again, they have some case studies in there that they did for class. So that's how I set it up. This is the cohort, and then they see each of their classes in here in a folder. And then when you go into the folder, for example, I'll go into Foundations for us. It's or you might name yours Fundamentals. I don't know. Everybody has different, slightly different names. This is my live class. So I'm not going to play in here. I'm just kind of showing you what it looks like. But over here in this add content button, that's how I added the folder. So something you have to remember is when you want to put your assignment, say you made your My Clinical assignment, you went into SimChart setup, you named it, and you put it, you hit publish, it'll publish just to that first folder. So you have to move it into your folder after it publishes because you can't rename any of those folders. Remember, the SimChart program's tied to that folder. Okay, so when you go into my foundations course, you'll see I have unit one, unit two folders. I like folders. Some of them are orange, you'll see, and some of them are blue. That's because I just hid the folder for the students so they didn't have to scroll. And then remediation at the bottom. So I did it by units. And then when they go in each unit folder, so if it's, you know, unit two, let's say, then they have each of their assignments in there. So unit two, day one, George Johnson neuro assessment. Unit two, day one, this is where they're just practicing the Glasgow score and they're charting on each other. So I didn't give the patient a name because it's doing on each other. And then we have Maude Crawford that I created for them to do mobility and they have to do their chart reviews every day. So does that give you kind of an idea? I mean, you don't have to do it the way I do it, of course. But I just kind of give you an idea of how to organize the courses.
Maddie, this is Tara Tanner.
Yes.
I have a question. So if they wanted to use just one course shell, can they go to the My Clinicals? Can they go to SimChart Setup and set up, create folders that would say, you know, N100, N102, 103, 104, second semester, N102, 103, 104, third semester, and then go into those folders and create assignments for those within there?
You can do it within SimChart, but you have to organize your course on Evolve. Do you guys use like Blackboard or one of those platforms? Do you know what I'm talking about?
Angel, yes.
It's this Angel, so it's the same thing, right? You go into Angel for your course, it's blank. You have to create your little units and folders.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. So when you go into SimChart and do stuff, you can create those folders in SimChart, and I have that also, I'll show you. You can create those folders in SimChart, but it's not going to automatically make the folder in your Evolve platform. So you want to make your course organized on the Evolve platform and then put all the stuff from SimChart into your courses. However, I have everything organized just like you're seeing in the SimChart setup, just the same way as I do on the Evolve platform. But it won't automatically do that for you. It's two different. It's the program talking to the platform.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, you're lost on that part.
Okay. So on Evolve, you have to create your course just like you would on Angel, however you want it organized. So like I said, I organize it by cohort and by courses, and then within each course, I make folders for their units. When you're in SimChart, when you're in SimChart, see how I'm in SimChart? Yeah. And I created a clinical. Mm-hmm. My clinicals, they're just a titled assignment. You won't have to edit them or move them from one class to another. All you do is make a title. So there's nothing to edit. You just create a new one every time. Right. On the case studies, though, and simulations, I have it, look, organized the same way. Do you see that? 3305 foundations. And when I click on it, I have all my units. I created this. And I have unit one and the same assignments I created in here, just like you were saying. Do you see that?
Yeah.
But when I publish this assignment, it's not going to go automatically to this folder. Okay. It's just going to go to My Clinicals. The program makes it publish to the My Clinical folder or to the case study folder. I have to actually put the assignment into the folder I want once I publish it.
Okay.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
Because I created it. I created all this and I created all this. So the back-end programming is not there for it to automatically do that for me. All this program knows is that when I make a case study, it puts it in case study folder.
Okay. Does that?
Yeah, but I have one more question.
Okay.
Okay, so you were saying before, or I thought you said before, that like we have one account in one shell, and that when I go in there, I could see everybody else's assignment. Yet when you just went in to this one, I only see two courses.
Because this is my spring 2016 cohort. I haven't made a third semester. They started in spring, and right now it's summer, so they're in their second semester.
But are you the only one at your college that is using this?
I am the only one that creates assignments. All of the instructors use it. They grade the assignments. I am the only one. I get paid by my administration to be the only one to organize the course and create all the assignments just to make all the faculty ease of workload.
Okay, so you're saying that every student, you're the only one that has, I guess I'm just confused why we can't see all of your courses. You're just saying because they've only done the first two so far, that's the only two that we can see?
Yeah, I've only created two. First and second semester, they're in second semester right now as we speak.
But just for our purposes, like if we have, I don't know how many, 10, 9, something, I don't know, so 9. So we're all going to have all these different assignments and all these different courses in there. It seems like it's going to be more confusing.
At the same time, like you're going to use it in how many different courses in one semester, for not different cohorts. Not different cohorts, just one cohort. So my students who started first semester in spring, we use SimChart for their fundamentals clinical course. That's it.
I have a question. How long have you been using the SimChart?
About 4 years.
Okay, so how many semesters of nursing courses do your students take that they use this?
They use it in their clinicals all the way through and sometimes in their classes, depending if the instructors want to do case studies in class. So all of our stuff is tied to their clinical class.
So can you show us like the fall 15 cohort? Will there be more semesters?
Let me just show you the one.
Like, because it builds every semester is what you're
saying. Yeah, it builds every semester.
So we would make a cohort, and I would build in the Nursing 100 for my Nursing 100, but then they would go to Gail, and she'd have to build the Nursing 102 for
for their
the next semester. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
We won't have one person that will be designated to making the assignments.
Okay, so you then would all talk to each other and make sure that the students don't go insane when they come in here and everybody names stuff differently, right? Because if a different person's doing the next semester, they might think it looks better to do it this way, and then it confuses the students. It's not coherent all the way through.
Right.
Does that make sense?
It does, but it's...
How, Maddie, can I ask your question?
Yeah.
How did you get your administration to agree to pay just one person?
You are just good at talking to them. So what I did is, okay, I'll tell you kind of the genesis of it. I do want to teach you this, so I don't want you to feel like you're not getting all your training, but we had used several other electronic health records in the past. And what would happen was, I'll be completely honest, the faculty who were not good at the computer would start complaining to students that they hate the charting and they hate having to make assignments for charting, and I hate it. It doesn't matter. This is, and it could be, I won't name them all, but four different electronic health record systems. And they hated all of them universally. Well, we all hate charting, okay? Even as a bedside nurse, it is what it is. And one program is not better than another. I personally feel like ZimChart's the best, but obviously I'm here, so that's why I think that. But what would happen is those faculty that were so tied to paper charting would make whatever, you know, it's horrible, it's slow today, I can't get in, the students hate it, and the students never hated it really ever. It was always the faculty. I'm gonna be serious. And nobody wanted to take the time to create assignments. They want an assignment created, but you're not going to take the time to create it. So after we are on our third or fourth, actually this was our fourth charting system that we purchased, our administration said, what really is the bottom line issue with this? We have to teach charting. We don't want them to have to go to seven different hospitals through their nursing career and have to learn every other system out there. We just want to do one through their nursing school so they're not crazy too, and we don't have to spend, you know, 3 days of our orientation time teaching them how to chart at XYZ hospital. So bottom line, I thought, and I talked to them about, was that, you know what, no one wants to take the time to learn this program. Everybody, if you pay me to just do all of them, I'll do it at whatever percentage of my time. And that way I can keep it all organized in folders. It's consistent. It looks the same. And so they agreed because they were tired of purchasing different programs, thinking that every single program they tried didn't work, when in all actuality, completely honest with you, half the time it was the faculty.
How much release time do they give you to do it?
20% to do it for every class in the undergraduate program.
Okay.
20% of my FTE.
Okay.
So I don't just make the assignment though. The course instructor tells me what they want, gives me what everything they want to do. I create it, I show it to them. For example, I know nothing about OB, I'm a peds nurse. OB sat with me and I showed them how it worked. I created the assignment. I put them in the assignment. They took the assignment as a student and were like, no, I want this and I want this, and then I fixed it. And then I published it for them. Then all the other faculty have to do in any other semester is grade.
Okay.
And that just, I mean, that just worked for us. But I would say that if you're going to have a team of different, if all your course leads are going to create their own stuff, then I would have them meet as administration to have those course leads meet and make sure you agree upon how the course will look, so it's not super confusing and crazy for the students. It's not like five different ways.
Okay.
And I can tell you that there have been, I have a friend who works at the University of Hawaii in Manoa, and they dropped ZimChart because the faculty could not agree on how to do it. The students were so crazy, they couldn't find their assignments. So every faculty did it different. So whether you have somebody organize the entire course and then just let people do their own assignments and then you just organize it for them, or have some one person that creates assignments, I would highly recommend it. I have been across the country teaching this many times and have had the same information, same thing everywhere you go. We're all the same as faculty. Okay. So anyway, that's all my, that's enough of that with the advice stuff, but you get the idea. You can take a course just on Evolve to help you to organize it. But let's go back now. We did a My Clinical. I want you to see, has everybody been in to see what SimChart looks like in the charting area?
Yes.
Okay, good. So when you go into the assignment, so we did week one, patient one, I'm going to view it as a student. Right now, I just clicked to view as student so that I could see it, what the student sees, and kind of give you some advice on what you'll want to tell the students as they're doing their assignments. So when I do orientation to SimChart, I make sure that they watch the orientation video in the student resources. I have them do practice around in the practice assignments, play around in there. And then when I come to talk to them a little bit about SimChart in their course, I just go over some major things for that they need to remember when they're doing assignments. So someday it'll pop up. Okay, so first thing that pops up on the My Clinical assignment, obviously, it's named whatever I named it, so week one, patient one. Then it tells the objectives, and then it has whatever competencies you picked, if you did pick any. Then the student, all they do is click start assignment, and you'll see right here, they have to set up their patient information first off. To make it work, they need to choose whatever day they're in clinical. I'm just choosing today. Their patient identifiers, we use first initial, last initial. Pretty universal around. Everybody kind of does that. This is HIPAA compliant, so first initial, last initial is totally fine. The program right here, it says right here, HIPAA compliant. They've made sure. So don't worry about that. The most important thing is to pick the right patient floor so that the right charts show up. So make sure you say to the students, if you're in med-surg, you have to pick med-surg. If you're in peds, pick peds. If you're in mental health, pick psych. If you're in OB, you pick women's health. So that way you have, there's slightly different charts, obviously, for each kind of floor. So I just clicked on med-surg, and I'm in clinical. I'm a student in clinical. I have a female patient that's 58 years old, and I get to choose a cute little avatar, and then I put in the provider's first initial, last initial. So that would be the physician. Sometimes the student will think, especially in the first semester, that provider means themselves, but their student details are automatically populated down here. And their credentials, which for us, we use student nurse or SN, whatever you use for your credentialing, and click save. Then once they click save, they're in the charting system. So they just put in their patient details, and now they're in the inpatient charting, okay? Down here where it automatically popped up as preclinical manager, do you guys do prep work still, or do they just come in cold?
They just come in cold.
Yeah, that's pretty universal now. So this was created for those schools that were still doing prep work. Most schools now are not doing it anymore. But let me tell you, it's also nice for assignments added. So preclinical manager was the old, this is your prep work, this is your patient, this is the information you have to look up before you come to clinical. Now we do it ourselves too. They come in cold and they have to do this after they get back home, so after their day. So underneath here are some diagnoses, medications, labs, diagnostics, tests. This is so all they have is free text boxes. Do you see that? This is meant, the philosophy behind these ones as prep work was that they would go in and look up the information in whatever resources you have for your course, web resources or their textbook, and learn about the patho and then type it in here to prove that they understand that information. The way they do that is they start typing the diagnosis, like say dehydration, and it'll pop up and they just click on it. Then they choose whether it's primary, secondary, tertiary. They type in the patho phys, the therapeutic regimen. That would be what is the best regimen for dehydration that should be happening, like out of their textbook, not necessarily is happening on their patient. And then the current health problems and related functional changes would be what is happening on their patient right now. So they're comparing what the patho is to the what the required therapy, you know, the recommended regimen to what their patient is getting. Does that make sense to everybody? So it's all free text. They can copy paste into it. They can type it in, whatever. And the most important thing to tell students, here's another piece where you want to put a little asterisk next to your notes, is they must hit save after every single screen they're on. This is an internet program. So they want to save as they go, right? In case the internet goes down or something happens. So after I put in a diagnosis, I click the save box. And then I get that little confirmation. Do you see that green box popped up? Save is successful. That means I know the internet saved it. And this is the other thing students always want. So here's another little trick for you. Every time, universally, every time the student does something, they want to make sure and check that it showed up. Same thing you guys did. We're all the same adult learners. Students, even us, remember when you did your assignment and you said, where did it go? I want to see it. So the students will do the exact same thing. They'll say, okay, I charted it. Where'd it go? I want to see it. So it's right here under Save Diagnosis. Here they add the diagnosis. This tab is what they've already saved. So if I want to add another diagnosis, pneumonia, as my secondary, say I'm doing two diagnoses for this patient, then under the saved box, I'll see dehydration and pneumonia. They want to see everything that they typed in. See this little triangle right here? That's a caret. I call it a caret. You click on it and it opens up and they can see everything they did. They can delete it. They can edit and they can add another one. Okay. That is the same functionality for all of these. So if I click on medications, oh my gosh, it got faster. Thank you. If I click on medications, it's the same functionality. You see how they have these free text boxes? They start typing their medication. I'm just going to pick something easy, Tylenol. Choose it from the drop down. They need to put in the classification, route of administration, the dose is free text, frequency is free text, the day they ordered it. Then they can put in all those medication information. That they looked up their med, they know the action, the side effects, contraindications, nursing interventions, all of that is free text. So diagnosis, medications, lab tests, diagnostic tests, all of these under preclinical manager are just free text boxes where they can put in all the information about the diagnosis, meds, everything. So this is like little assignments for them, like you did for prep work or post work, whatever you guys do now. We do it all post work. So,
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sorry, I can't see your hand. Yeah,
that's okay. So, do you have your students when they go to clinical fill anything out in clinical, or do they just write out a piece of paper and then do all this afterwards?
So they do this afterwards. We want them to be doing in clinical. If they have a little bit of downtime, which we're always suspicious if they do, then they can get in here and do it. I mean, it's a web program. They can hop on the internet anywhere and do it. But we kind of advocate for them to be doing in clinical and take some notes and then go home and do these big assignment pieces.
Would all your facilities allow them to have access to the internet, though?
Some do and some don't.
Okay.
So, for example, one of our hospitals that don't allow it, the professor just would like them to have it done when they leave, just to kind of follow the day like any nurse. When you leave your shift, your charting is done. So they actually just reserve the computer lab at the hospital at the end of day for an hour, and they all go in and do their charting at the end of clinical.
And so I was just going to say, do you give them extra time, or do you shorten clinical, or do you just expect them to do it afterwards?
Nope, they're expected to do it after. They get their clinical time, and then they're expected to chart after their shift.
Okay, yeah, I was just curious, because right now we have, like, papers that they write on, and they can kind of do some of that, like at least.
Yeah, and some, yeah, it just depends. Some faculty, like at our children's hospital, they let them get on the internet and do their charting. So they can do it as they go, but they get in trouble if they're sitting there trying to do their whole assignment, right, for 2 hours.
I just was curious how you guys.
Yeah, yeah.
To have a paper that they filled out?
Yeah, they do have a little piece of paper that they can put their notes on. So we call it their brain, but it has extra information on it for them to fill in.
Okay.
Yeah, good, great question. Yeah. So they do this preclinical manager here that was set up for the old-fashioned prep work. They do this post now, our students. But they're here any way you want to do the assignment. The best thing I can say about these assignments, though, is you know, charting can be a little bit overwhelming even after you've been a nurse for a while and you have multiple patients. So the best advice I can give is match the charting to the objectives of the week. So for example, if they're in fundamentals, like you saw my assignment, and they learned neuro assessment, they're just charting neuro assessment. They're not charting everything they did that day in clinical. So I pick the major things, even in second semester, they go in when they're at the hospital. And I pick whatever they're doing that week is the big thing they chart on, and all the rest of it, they always have to chart, you know, a head-to-toe assessment, and then they have to do these preclinical manager assignments after. So what I'm saying is, like, eat the elephant a bite at a time. If you go in with the thought that they're going to chart everything first day, everything they do in clinical, go into SimChart and chart it, it's a bit overwhelming. So anyway, just some advice for that. Okay, so that's the preclinical manager. You can use that for assignments. Again, we have, like in our maternity course, we have a bunch of assignments where they just do those pieces, and that's their whole assignment. So in class, they don't necessarily have to be in clinical to use the program. So we do that too, and that just, it's easy to put all the assignments into one place. Okay, above that is your inpatient charting. So we would have here patient charting. Oh, see how it's reminding me to save? Okay, so inpatient charting. Patient charting is that orange bar now, and underneath that came up with all the things that you're going to use probably most often, the student will use for charting. So the first one is admission history, and then system assessment. So that's all the head-to-toe assessment in each system. There's discharge planning, teaching, interventions, basic nursing cares, a bunch of things. But let me just show you as an example for time-wise, system assessment, which you probably would use most often. So system assessments is where you would go in and do your respiratory, neuro, skin assessment, all those. So there's all these gray boxes that pop up. We have a complete head-to-toe assessment that's free text. To practice their, do they remember? So we do this as their final one at the end of first semester. They have to chart their head to toe on their own, free text. Or you can go into each system. For example, let's go into respiratory. And they would chart it just like they do in the electronic health records in the hospital by clicking the boxes and buttons, okay? So, for example, for respiratory, here's what you need to remind the students, though. This is, and you know this already, though, but I'll say it here, is that they will want to click everything when they start. So you have to keep reminding them you're only charting what you did and what you assessed. Don't worry that us really anal nurses helped create this program and put everything under the sun in here. You're only charting what you did. So we have the respiratory pattern, and all they have to do is click the box, see the check box. Respiratory effort, there's these little internal scroll bars. And that, put that another star by that. Everybody does not see these internal scroll bars. They think these are all their choices right here. So something to remember and tell people, there are scroll bars, not just this scroll bar out here, but sometimes there's little internal scroll bars with more information. So then respiratory effort, they click that box. Then you've got lung auscultation. So this, when you click on the lung field, it brings up the charting information to the right. So say he's got a clear right, left upper lobe, and then we go in the right upper lobe, we would chart something else. Let's say they had wheezing in the right upper. So it doesn't go away. So when they click on a new box, they think that the last thing went away. So if I go back to that first left upper lobe again, see, it still clicked clear.
Excuse me.
Yes.
A question.
Yes.
I'm looking down at the bottom where I have the save button.
Mm-hmm.
My save button is grayed out. Is that just because of what's going on with the computer being slow, or is there a way for me to unlock the save button?
As soon as you start turning, it should let you hit the save button.
I clicked on different categories, and it says here respiratory assessment unsaved, and so I went down to the bottom, and it's grayed out.
I think on the left-hand, I've been playing with it. On the left-hand side, you have to be in a certain category in order for it to...
No, I think it's because she's in the same patient as Maddie. You can only have one person in control at a time.
Oh, are you in my same patient, or are you in your own patient that you created? That's probably...
Yeah, no, I wasn't able to save my patient that I created either. Only Dana and yourself, according to what I have here, have one of our faculty and yourself have saved patients. Shows up. It may be because we have multiple people in the same patient and in a database that'll automatically lock you out.
Okay, that makes
control.
Sense.
First person in gets control.
Okay.
And we have lots of people that are in. So I'm thinking it's a database control thing.
All right, thank you.
It might be, but the students won't have that, I promise. They'll all be able to go into the same one assignment that you make, and they can all chart on it. And they'll all have their own. It's by their login. So I've had past electronic health records we purchased in the past that every student can see what every other student is charting, like the real hospital. This one is not like that. They can all go into that one assignment you created, and they all have their own separate assignment.
Do you mean logical and student view?
Yeah.
Because if you didn't go into student view, that's because of two people learning as only one instructor but multiple students.
Oh, there it is. Thank you. That's good to know.
Oh, I see. You went in as instructor. Sorry, I can't see your screens, or I could help you.
It's okay. It's a learning curve here.
So I went in as student. Yeah. Okay.
In trying to work on the same assignment, that'll be how you know somebody else on your team is working on that because.
Yeah, we're all instructors, so we can't. If I were enrolled as a, if I enrolled you as a student, then you could go in and do it.
Perfect.
Does that make sense? You're enrolled as an instructor. Okay, so let me just kind of show you this, and then we'll ask if you have more questions. I'm sorry, timing is like you need 7 hours, I swear, to look at everything, but this gives you an idea of what the assessments look like, system assessments. So some have pictures. They don't go away. Like I said, when I clicked on a new picture, a student might think their charting went away. If I go back, you'll see it's still there. There's the X's and the clear that I put in. A lot of times, too, you'll see these grayed out boxes, and the students, like, I'm trying to type in. Excuse me.
Oh. Yeah.
Allergy season. Okay. A lot of time in these grays box, you're like, why is this not going? It's because we haven't clicked something to open that box. So do you see right here, I have to say oxygen is in use, and then I have to click liters per minute, and then it will allow me to type. 2 liters per minute, say. So the student will just kind of click on it and think they can hurry and type, but they haven't said whether or not they're using liters per minute or percent oxygen. You know, there's a lot of different things, and they won't be used to that right off the bat. So I've got 2 liters and maybe on nasal cannula. So you can just keep clicking, click. They don't have to fill everything in to hit save at the bottom. And then when they're done, they just click save and it's saved. So what is the first thing the students want to see now? What do they want to know? What do you think they're going to want to know right there? I hit save. What did you guys want to know after you hit publish?
Where
did it go? What they'll do is they'll go into respiratory and they'll say, it's all gone. It's deleted. Look at this. But what they don't understand is how electronic health records work. And that's why we're teaching this in nursing school also, is that every time they go in to do a respiratory assessment, it lets them do another one. So they have to pull up the report or pull up the safe charting to see what it is, what they charted previously. So what I tell them is you need to find little blue words at the top. See how up here it says show safe charting? When I click on that, it'll show what I've already charted. When I go into respiratory assessment, it's blank because I can go ahead and chart another one if I want to 5 minutes later or 2 minutes later. So they can chart it this as many times as they want. But to see what they've already charted, if they click up here, show, save charting, and if they click on the system assessment itself, it'll bring it up and they can see what they've charted. Let's say they made a mistake and it wasn't even breathing. They were shortness of breath, but it wasn't even. If they click on even, it will ask them, do you want to delete it? Hit okay, and look how what it does. It just crosses it out, just like paper charting. And the reason we had Elsevier do this is so the students can see that what they charted does not go away even when they delete it. They think they made a mistake and delete it. It does not go away. So we know that from old paper charting. Remember how we used to cross it out and initial it? So what they don't understand is now that it's electronic, it still doesn't go away in the back end of the computer. But they think they can delete what they did. We don't want them to know. We don't want them to think that. We want to just show them that what you charted and put in as a deletion stays in the patient record. So this is just a visual for the student to understand that their mistakes are still saved on the back end of the computer. We don't see that in the hospital. We can delete stuff. It's still saved, though, on the back end in the record. Okay. Does that make sense to everybody? So once they delete it, then they have to go back in and to respiratory assessment and say, whoops, I meant to say labored, and hit save again. So now when they look at their show save charting, this one and this one, they'll have two assessments, one at 9:13 and one at 9:16. For me, sorry, it's probably 10 something for you, 10:16 and 10:13. System assessments under here, there's my crossed out even, and when I pull up this one, it says labored. That's all that's in here. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm gonna quickly go back over what we just did. We learned that in the preclinical management is all free texting and free charting to do either prep work or post-work assignments on diagnosis, meds, lab tests, and diagnostics. Then on the inpatient record, we learned that in patient charting, they can go in and chart a full head-to-toe assessment, free text, or each system assessment separately. They can go in and delete what they've charted, but it doesn't disappear. Especially good for us as instructors, you can see the mistakes the student has made, and you can ask them why. So I find that really important to ask them why they did that the first time and to see if they actually just clicked the wrong thing or to see if they listened to somebody else and changed their answer at clinical. And I will say things to them like, well, do you think you could have heard something different from your preceptor that was teaching you at 8, and when you went in at 10 to do it yourself, do you think you could have heard of something different and still be correct? And teach them that charting is what they hear, what they see, all of that kind of information and critical thinking. So I think it's good to be able to see the mistakes they make in there. So that's why we left that in there to where it just crosses it out and you can see everything they did. Okay, anyway, that was just a little explanation. Also, under system assessment, and this can be confusing for students, so I let them know that there's also pain assessment in there. So a lot of places teach pain assessment as the fifth vital sign. So we have pain assessment under system assessment, safety assessment, and special precautions and isolation assessment is also under systems assessment. So that's not intuitive to me personally. So I just wanted to let you know, if you can't find safety or special precautions, it's under system assessment. FYI.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What about a surgical site? Like, I see that you have wounds and drains, but you don't have a separate surgery.
So wounds and drains is where we're going to type all of wounds, whether it's surgical, pressure ulcer, doesn't matter. All of it will be under that same place. So for example, if you go into wounds, I'll show you that right now, actually, that you asked.
Yeah, because most hospitals have wounds like a dehumidifier or something. And then
as an adverse wound, yeah.
And they have a specific surgery assessment.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, in here, they just chose to put everything under the same spot. So anything that's whether it's a surgical wound or pressure ulcer wound or a trauma wound, it's all under wounds. Mm-hmm. So just, yeah, that was a good question. And we can look at that right now because that's the system assessment, discharge planning, all those system interventions, they all work just like the system assessment did. So all the functionality is the same. You can look through those, but that all works the same way. For wounds, IVs, drains, tubes, ostomies, and injection sites, so everything under here, wounds, IVs, all of that, these ones all work the same way and have the same functionality. So if we just go into wounds, IVs, drains, ostomies, and injection site works the same way. So for example, wound, like you said, surgical wound, if we were going to do that, you just have the student just clicks on the anatomical site that the wound is. So let's just do an abdominal. So then it will bring up charting underneath this anatomic picture. And then the student will choose the wound category under here. So you see how the first one's surgical, body modification, burns, lesions, pressure ulcers. So they have any of those can choose. So it's all surgical sites, any modifications, all types of burns, all of it. And then it will bring up the information depending on which one they choose. So look, if I hit surgical, it'll bring up suture, staples, surgical glue, pins. If I click on burns, it brings up the degree. First degree, second degree, third degree. It automatically fills in the next section. I bring up lesions, open wound, skin tear, abrasion, laceration, bruising, puncture, animal bite, everything. If you click on pressure ulcers, it'll ask you the staging. So what stage of wound of pressure ulcer? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or SR, sorry, necrotic. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So they chose to put it all in one place. So whatever type of wound, it's all going to be in here, and they just have to choose the correct category, and it will auto-fill it in for them. So let's just choose burn, for example. And if I were the student and I chose second degree burn, do you see how now it filled in all the other information related to a second degree burn?
Yeah.
Okay. And you see how it won't let the student click on depth? It's grayed out. This is great when I'm working with students because they're like, this stupid thing won't let me put a depth. And I'm like, well, does a second degree burn have a depth? So it's kind of a teaching tool too. You can figure out what's going on in their minds. It's kind of nice. So I'm like, if it does have a depth, then you certainly do not have a second degree wound. You have a third degree. So it sort of helps them a little bit. It gives them the clues, but it also is a nice little teaching tool when they get confused. You can actually see that whether they understand what they're doing or not. So if I click second degree, I can put the length and the width in. Then I can do the wound area. So is it pink, red, blistery, whatever. And then we can do drainage and exudate. Here's what I wanted to show you right here. It does not matter what section you're in. There will always be notes. Do you see down here this free text box that I'm typing in? There will always be a free text box. So no worries. If the student cannot figure out and don't understand, tell them, don't make yourself crazy. If you can't find it, put it in the notes section, the burn, blah, blah, blah. And you can find it when you're grading. But sometimes if they like don't understand the vocabulary yet, if they've never been in a hospital and they're in first semester, sometimes they have a hard time. Just let them know that there will always be a free text section that they can use too. Okay. So then you're going to do the dressings, solutions, interventions. And again, they do not have to have something in here. If they went in here and they're just charting the wound, but they didn't do any interventions, they don't have to click a box in there. And then what is the most important, before I do something else, what's the most important thing to do for the student?
Save it.
Click save, exactly. And then I get my confirmation green box that says your save was successful. And then the first thing they ask you is, where did my charting go, right? So right down here, for some reason it's at the bottom instead of at the top. I think it should be at the top where everything else is, but whatever. The wound review is down here. All of these ones, IVs, drains, tubes, ostomies, they all look like this. And the review is down here. So if I click on wound review, then it brings up everything I charted. Look, here's an internal scroll bar again. Okay. Everything I charted. If they are coming back to chart on the same wound again, you guys, and that's for any of these wounds, IVs, like they'll chart on their IV several times, right? They just click that same spot they clicked before. So I'm going to click that number one and it will let me chart on it again. Okay. So then I can chart again. Let me just click a few things so you can see what I mean. And then I hit save again. And when I do wound review, you'll see I charted on this wound number one twice in the day. Does that make sense? And that's the same. I'll show you, look, when you go into IVs, same anatomical spot. You choose your IV site. You chart underneath here. You look at IV review. When you go into ostomies, same thing. You choose the spot. Brings it up down here, and ostomy review to see what's already charted. So all these wounds, IVs, drains, ostomies, and injection sites, they all look the same. And they just pick the body part, right? And then they chart what they're doing. This is a sub-Q, and it'll bring up the information, any actions, and any notes. And then they click save, confirmation, and then review what I charted, okay? Questions on any of this patient charting section?
I have a question. If we were gonna, if we wanted to pull up everything that this student did, is there like a print summary of what like a student submitted for this week?
Yes. So yeah, then that's in your site. So right now we're in the student view.
Okay.
And I'll show you that. When I come out, I'll show you that.
Okay.
But the student themselves will want to see everything they charted too. So that is a good question from the student point of view. What, before they submit their assignment, see up here, they can hit submit their assignment, right? The super anal ones are going to be like, let me just see everything I did and check it off that I did what I was supposed to, right? So the way they will do that is they will go down to reports. Do you see reports right here? If they click on reports and then reports, up here, the very first box, view all charting to date. And they click the entire hospital stay and generate, and then click generate. It'll bring up everything they charted. And they can look at their little checkoff sheet and go, yes, I charted everything I was supposed to and I did it right. See that? This is everything I charted. Here's the respiratory assessment. It's in chronological order. Here's the wounds I charted. Here's the injection site. They can print it for themselves. They can do an HTML so they can save it to their computer as a file. Okay. You can do multiple things with that. So the student, when they say, I want to see everything I did and make sure I did it right, they want to go to reports. View all the charting. They can, you know, pull a report for each little thing if they want, but usually they want to see all of it. View all for the whole hospital stay, generate, and that'll pull up everything they charted that they can see. Okay? So that was a good question. Not on the instructor side, though. We're a student right now. So on the student side, they can do that under reports. Okay, any other questions with patient charting? Do you guys kind of get an idea how that works?
Yep.
Okay, and I show you this because it's kind of important to understand what the student sees, so you know what the assignments you want to make. You know what I mean? And they'll ask you questions too. So don't skip over learning this because the students will ask you questions on how to find stuff. All right, so on special charts, you see this one right here with the little arrow? This is just all those other charts that usually are in some drawer somewhere in the hospital, right? There's the SBAR report sheet. We have those at primaries. You don't, this is not part of the SBAR is not part of the medical record, right? We have those little sheets to help nurses call the doctor at the hospitals. But we put it in the internal electronic health record so the students could practice it for us, and then we can see it and grade it. Braden scale, FLAC scale, functional dementia, geriatric depression. So all those other things, all those skills and restraints and flow sheets, if you're just looking for one little thing, the seizure activity, the sleep disorder screening, as much as you can think of. If you can't, if you're not sure where that would be, just check special charts real quick. And look, there's pain assessment again. Pain is in multiple places. So it's in our assessment, system assessment. It's in special charts, and it's in vital signs. I'm going to show you vital signs next. A little bit confusing, so I want to tell you about this. Vital signs has everything the CNA can do or the tech, okay? So if you are trying to find intake and output, it's under vital signs. Doesn't make any sense to me, but that's where it is. Vital signs is everything the tech or the CNA does. So vital signs, intake, output, height, weight, and the little blood glucose, the bedside blood glucoses. Okay. These all look the same. These under vital signs have the same functionality, and they have trending data. So it's kind of nice. If the student were to go ahead and put in all of the information, let's see, they can put in Celsius or Fahrenheit on the temperature and it will fill in the rest for them. I'm just gonna quickly fill this all in so you can see what I mean. And I'm putting in a blood pressure and the site, sitting, lying, sats. Say they're on room air, and this is all just random, so don't mind me. So they do have to put in the site or it won't save. So tympanic, radial pulse, digital probe on the toe. I don't know. I'm a peds nurse, so I automatically like pick weird stuff. And like I said, in every spot there is the notes section if they want to say anything in there. Then up here on the right, do you see this pain assessment? There's a link to the pain assessment. So you know, if your school teaches pain assessment as part of the fifth vital sign, some people do that, it's right here. So you can teach them that way. You don't have to show them every way it's done, just the way you teach it at your school, and they can get to it in that way too. Once they put everything in, they click save, right? The most important thing is to click save. And because it shows trending data on these ones, they'll see every time they put in vital signs, they'll see it in this table. And they'll see it on a graph so they can see the trending data throughout the day. So if they were to go ahead and put another temperature in, and I save it again, it'll show up on the graph and it'll be one right after the other, okay? Questions? And that works the same for the intake output, looks the same, gives you the trending data, height and weight, trending data, blood glucose, trending data, okay? So just wanted you to see the difference in the charting of those ones. All right, we have patient teaching, care plans, all of that in MAR, right? So they can give their meds, but here's the thing. This is an open chart. There won't be a medication in here for them to chart to give unless they order the medication. So they'd have to put the med in first, and then they can give it. They can chart giving it. Does that make sense? So I usually do medications. Personally, I just do it down here as a post-clinical thing in this medication free texting to tell me all about it. I usually don't have them chart giving their meds in an MAR because then they'd have to sit and order all the medications before they could chart them. So just FYI, they can do that. It's possible. It's just, I don't feel like it's as useful. I put in all the medications when they're in the simulation center or when they're doing the case studies. So then they just go into the MAR and chart it. It's already there because I put it in for them. This one is just an open chart. There's no way of knowing, right? When we make the assignment, I don't know what meds the student's going to give. So they would have to put it in themselves. So just an FYI on that. But just to show you how that works, have you guys all tried giving a med? If I were to put in a med under pharmacy, same way, let's just do Tylenol. I would type in the medication I'm giving. So I put in Tylenol. Let's just do Tylenol tablet. Routine, I'd have to put in all of this. I'm going to give it, oh, PRN, oral, 500 milligrams every 6 hours starting today. And I'd have to add the order, and I can add as many as I want, then submit the order. And now when I go to the MAR, there's the Tylenol to give. So I don't find that useful for students to have to sit there and put in orders before they give them personally in the clinical site. I would rather them learn about the medication. So I usually use the medication assignment in the preclinical manager. Just letting you guys know that. It is very useful for simulation. Then I put all the meds in. They go in to do their sim, and they have to go in and chart it when they give the med in the sim center. So how they chart giving the med is they can click the green circle button, ask them what time they administered the medication. Here's another thing that's weird. FYI, everywhere in sim chart, put a little star, something to remember. The times are two different fields. So you can't just go 09:30, but I stay in the hour field. So 09 tab 30 to the minutes. I have to tab from the hours to the minutes. Then again, there's a notes section. Then they put their initials that they gave the medication, and all important, they hit save. And you see down here, does it like the old-fashioned MAR? Again, just to show them the information doesn't disappear and their name is attached to it. It's kind of a visual for the student to see. So it crosses out the time just like old-fashioned paper charting, puts in the new time that they gave it and their initials. All right. That's how that works. Questions?
I think we're good there.
Okay. Care planning, of course, everybody wants to see the care planning. That's on the inpatient record. That's not on the preclinical, post-clinical manager. Some people do it, you know, they want to do it post. But we have, you know, care plans as part of our clinical record in the hospital. So it's up here on the inpatient record. The care planning on here is a fill-in-the-box situation again. It uses... NANDA, sorry, I had a brain cramp. We don't use NANDA anymore here. We stopped doing it. So I had a brain cramp. NANDA, it uses NANDA. So is everything in here pre-populated for NANDA diagnoses, nursing diagnoses? So if you still use those, you can just choose it. The way this works is first they choose the medical diagnosis. So I think I had like, what, dehydration or something. So I start typing dehydration, and it'll pop up in the box. See that? Click on dehydration, and then it asks the nursing diagnosis. So first the medical diagnosis, and then they made it real easy and had a lot of nursing diagnoses that were connected to those. It doesn't have to be the same, obviously, right? But just to make it easier for the student, they kind of organized the NANDA diagnoses tied to the medical diagnosis to give them an idea of the difference between what a medical diagnosis is and a nursing diagnosis so they can see it right in front of them. So then they would pick whatever the patient has, constipation, let's say, risk of constipation, as an actual or potential. Then they can do their related to, as evidenced by, and they can click all these boxes, whichever their patient, expected outcome, and they have to type in a time frame or it won't save, okay? And then their intervention, they can click that, and they have to type in a rationale for why they chose the intervention or it won't save. So it forces them to do the measurement and the rationale, which is great because that's what my students would always forget to do when they were doing it on paper. So they forces them to do that, and then all they do at the very bottom is click save again, and they have a nursing diagnosis saved in their care plan. They can do as many as they want, but let me just let you know that if you don't use NANDA or they can't figure out what to pick, so let me go ahead and put dehydration again, whatever I had, dehydration. And let's say I wanted to go, it wasn't a risk for constipation, they actually have constipation. I can add whatever diagnosis I want to. So then you don't even have to use NANDA. If you don't use NANDA, you don't even have to do that at all. There's the add new right here at the top. So I could say constipation is actual, it's not a risk of, right? Right here, and I click add, and now it added constipation for me as my actual. But when I open these, you'll see it's not pre-populated anymore because I put my own in. I have to keep putting my own in. Related to no stool in 5 days. And then I have to click add again as evidenced by abdominal cramping and verbalize no stool. And I have to click add again. And then my expected outcome, it's blank again. So if I do my own, I have to do it all myself. I love to do this with students and have them think it through themselves. My expected outcome may be stool by end of shift. Oh, stool today, stool. Forgot what makes them do the time frame. So then the time frame would be by end of shift. And then my intervention, maybe I'm going to give an enema, add, and why feels full and can't go himself, herself. I had a girl, didn't I? Herself. And add. Then at the very bottom, I hit save. Okay. Does that make sense to everybody? I did that really fast.
That's fine.
Okay, so there is the dehydration one where I just did it all myself, and then I have the dehydration one where I use the NANDA Nick and Knock stuff, and then it pulls it in there for them. Okay, so they can do that. They can put as many as they want with the same. They can keep putting in the same medical diagnosis and add as many nursing diagnoses as they want. And the last thing they can do is go ahead and prioritize them. So if they have multiple in here and you want them to think through and know what's the most important, second most important, so that you can look at their critical thinking skills, then you can have them prioritize it. They don't have to, but if you ask them to, then they can. Okay. Now, a lot of people ask me, once I've saved it, where do they do their evaluation? After it's saved is when they do their evaluation. So now I have these saved care plans in here. Over here, I expand it. And if I look down here, there's evaluate button at the bottom. So within the saved care plan, already saved, click evaluate. And then they can do their evaluation on their expected outcome. If it's reached, not reached, and then put in all their free texting of everything, all the information you guys want them to put in for the outcome. And then the intervention, effective or ineffective. And we usually, you know, make them say why it was ineffective, what they would do next, that kind of thing in the comment box. And click save. So now they have a, reached, save. Now they have an outcome for this and an evaluation. All right. Any questions? Anything else you want to see before we go to the grading? So that was just all seeing it on the student side.
I think we're good.
Okay, so to grade it. So this is another, it doesn't matter if you're doing My Clinicals or any of those, you can, you go to the same place to grade. So we're gonna come out of here because I'm in as a student, right? So I'm gonna click out of here. And I wanna stop being a student. I wanna be the faculty member again. So I'm gonna click out of that. And to grade, you can either do sim chart setup or go straight to the assignment, either one. Okay. So what I tell my instructors, I don't let, because I'm the only one that makes assignments, I don't let anybody go. I don't want them to go into sim chart setup. I tell them just to click on the assignment and go straight to the assignment to grade. So for example, week one, patient one is the one we just did, right? We put a lot of saved stuff in there. And when I click and access the simulation now, it comes up for grading. So Gail, me, and Dana all did this as a student and put in their, I mean, we're in our assignment.
Can you go back again? Tell me, yeah.
Okay, one more time. So.
So where am I going back? Because I think so it says I'm in as me. So uh-huh. Go into My Clinicals?
Yep, so I went into My Clinicals.
Uh-huh.
I've clicked on the assignment I created. If you're in your own assignment, want to grade your own, click on the one that you created. So I'm going to click on my assignment that I created and click to access the simulation. And then it pulls up all the students who are working on that assignment.
How come I didn't get mine? Is it in there? And I know I did it.
You might have clicked on someone else's.
Oh, okay.
So it could be, you have to click on, it doesn't matter which assignment you click on. I'm just going to show you how to grade it. But I went into mine and then I clicked on mine to grade it. But it doesn't matter who you go into. So let me go back to My Clinicals and whoever created this one, clinical one, patient one. If I go into that one, it looks like nobody was in that assignment. If I go into practice, and there's multiple practices. It's like nobody did one on that one.
Now, can you do, that was me, and I tried to do it, and I had no way of, can you run me through that? Go into practice.
Practice, which one?
I don't care.
Okay.
Yeah, so click to access. And
so nothing in here, because were you unable to save?
Yeah, well, you see how it just says no data available? How do I put the practice? How do I do this?
Okay, if you want to follow along, come into week one, patient one with me. And you can look at myself or Gail or Dana.
No, I want to learn how to do it myself. I don't want to look at those three. How would I have put one into that list is what I'm asking.
You would not. The student would.
When I was a student, I couldn't do it either.
So anytime the student hits save, so I'm in a student, when I go in as a student and I go back into my assignment, it's all still there.
You as a student.
You go in as the student and you put in all the data. So just use the one I did.
Okay. So you have to put in all your data.
You save something. It doesn't really matter right now. You will never do this. This is what the student will do. Does that make sense? I was just showing you what it looks like as a student.
Okay. I was just curious because two of my peers were able to do it seamlessly and myself, I couldn't.
Yeah. And it's just because however you went into it, however you went into the assignment in the first place, which the student will never have to deal with. They won't have two profiles. They'll always be a student who doesn't. It'll just show up. So to learn how to grade, so I'm putting in another assignment right now. If I put in anything, it doesn't really matter. So I'm just going to put in a temperature. That's it. And I come back out and I get out of a student. I'm not a student. It doesn't, you won't be a student. You don't have to be a student. I'm just, we're just doing this so you can see what the students see. It's don't get distressed if you're not in here. Doesn't matter. This will be a list of your students who've done the assignment, which they don't have another profile. They won't be all in one big group. They won't be like five instructors doing it at the same time. So they all have their own profile. And this, you won't be in here either. It'll just be the student. So when I go to grade the student, and go ahead and pick one of these, it does not matter, and I click grade, you'll see that it will generate a report for me. So I can generate a report for everything they've charted, or I can go in here and see what they've already charted in progress. So they have not submitted the assignment. Do you see all the spots I've charted in here? Shows it right next to it. Three times in here, the student charted in system assessment. So I can go and look at what they charted in system assessment. Oh, labored breathing. And then I can leave them a comment. So I can say, in system assessment, why did you delete even breathing, for example, and hit save?
Can I ask you, did you go in under remarks? Can you do that again?
Yep, let me do that again. Sure. Yeah. I usually repeat myself a couple times. I was trying to speed up to give you guys more time. Sorry. No, so in patient charting, when I go into grade, so everything we did between naming the assignment and right now was all the student view. You will never have to do that unless you want to see what your assignment looks like that you created. Okay, so to create your assignment was super easy. You just named it, done. To grade the assignment, I went into the assignment, and then it pulled up a list of all the students who are working on the assignment. Do you see how it says in progress? The student has not submitted it. Okay, so all I did to go grade the assignment, clicked on the assignment, clicked open, there they all are. That's it. To make an assignment, I just went in SimChart Setup, named it, and hit publish. To grade it, I go into My Clinicals, click on the assignment, open it, there I am. All right, so for this one, the students are in progress. We did not submit. I wanted to show you the difference so that you can see what the student is charting before they submitted their assignment. And a lot of instructors like to help out in the fundamentals or in the clinical with their charting before they actually submit and their assignment is final. So all you do is choose your student. So I just chose Maddie and I'm gonna click grade and generate a report. I can view all their charting and all the charting to date and run report, and it'll bring up all that they have charted.
So when you were writing a comment, you were writing it in the remarks?
I was writing it in, I'm gonna back up and do it again. So then I'm going into grade, I click on patient charting, open, choose my student. I can also do you see how this in progress view the EHR over here? That is if I want to actually go into the student's assignment and make a comment in their assignment as they're working on it.
I think it's important to note, too, that the step-by-step instructions for what Maddie's showing you right now are in the instructor resources. So I think if we hang up from Maddie, we'll jump back into instructor resources because that might help tie some things together. You know what I mean? Said with screenshots, too. Like, I'm in right now, so it's step-by-step with screenshots, so that will help.
Yeah.
Okay, so
everything I just said will be in there, yeah.
Okay, so Maddie, the question that I had, though, is if you don't want to add a comment, you just want to grade it once they submit it, okay? So we don't have one that's already submitted, right? Like, can you grade one that they have?
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to do that right next. So once the student has submitted their assignment, it'll look like this to the student. They won't be able to get in again. It'll be closed to them. They've submitted it. They turned in their assignment to you. It's done. Then when you go into grade, same process. I click clinical one, patient one, click on my assignment, open it, and I'll have our list of students that completed their assignment. So you see how this one says ready for grading now instead of in progress? So if I click on that student's name and then click grade, it'll bring up their full assignment done. You can't go in and look at it in progress anymore. They've done their whole assignment. To grade this full assignment, all you do is, you see here at the bottom is the overall grade. All you do is open each section and you can grade each section independently, and it will automatically fill in these gray boxes at the bottom. So for example, if you do your preclinical manager as one assignment separate from their inpatient charting assignment, you can give them those points from your rubric and remarks, and it will automatically put it in here, the bottom. If you grade your care plan separately from their inpatient charting, it'll automatically pre-populate that. And then their inpatient charting, I just did a tympanic on that one really fast. You can grade their inpatient charting and it will automatically pre-populate that for you. So a lot of people have those as three separate assignments, their care plan, their prep work or post work, and their inpatient charting. If you have it all as one assignment, then you can just do the overall grade at the bottom and remarks. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yep.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yep. Okay. So create the assignment and grade the assignment took me like, what, 30 seconds, 2 minutes to show you how to do. So it's really easy from the instructor side. Everything I was showing you in between was the student doing the assignment. Just you could see what the possibilities were and you would understand the things that you'd have to tell the students, so you don't have issues between when you give them instructions and telling them that there's those internal scroll bars. Hit save at the bottom of every screen, and the way they have to click on the pictures or the boxes, or they can leave comments. It just kind of gives you an idea of what assignments you may want to create and what instructions you may want to give them. So that is, I mean, that's it. That's super easy. The grading was really easy. I'm going to go over the two most important things as the instructor. I do want you guys, though, you should go through as a student, try some practice assignments and see what it is the students would be looking at, so you can, you know, have good information on how to instruct the students and how to create assignments. But one thing I want you to just repeat real quick, I'm going to repeat really quick, how to create assignment. You go into what?
SimChart setup.
Right, SimChart setup. Automatically comes up to My Clinicals. You give it a title. You click Publish. You can opt out if you want, which I always do. And you're done. That's how you create the My Clinical assignment. It's much more difficult to do a case study and a simulation. That you can have another, they'll be happy to set you up another webinar to go through all of that information. Then you're like, well, how do I grade it then? So to grade, you just click on the assignment, open it, choose the student you're going to grade. If they're not, if they're in progress, you have to go into in progress, or you can generate a report. I'm going to hit grade. Say my student just totally forgot to submit it. Whatever, it doesn't matter. I can still look at it. And run report. Run report. And to grade it, you go open each of the little boxes. You can grade each one independently, and it'll fill in the bottom, or you can give them an overall, and you can do all your remarks in the free text box. Very simple to grade.
Maddie, do all those grades filter into an online grade book that the faculty can then just see on the site, or do they have to actually manually record those somewhere?
This program does not automatically connect because everybody has different platforms. So like you guys said, you had Angel, some people have Blackboard, some people have different things, so it doesn't connect.
It's a built-in grade book to chart.
Yes, it has its own gradebook in SimChart in Evolve. So when I do this grading and I click save, that saves the stuff that I've done. To give it back to the student on SimChart, I just hit post to Dropbox and okay. So that's the number one thing my instructors forget to do. They forget to post it to Dropbox, that sends it back to the student.
But it does that now take, Say I've graded a student and I want to see what grades I've given that student throughout the semester. Where do I pull up all those grades? That summary of the grades I've given.
All the grades? Oh, yes. So when you go into SimChart Setup and Grading, you can go under all the assignments. See how it has all the assignments? If I go into Clinicals, here's all the assignments that were created. Here's my week one patient one. And then it has all of the students that have grades or not grades, if I put them in or not. Whoops, I clicked out. Sorry, let me go back in. So I went into grading and my clinicals assignments, and then has all of the assignments in there. So here's everybody who's done the assignment. Here's clinical one, patient one, and GI assessment, Mr. Jones, somebody did. Week one, patient one, and that was the one we did. And then it will have all of the data in here of everybody. Okay, so because I just did my own personal one, there's not a big long list. So once all the grades are in, you will see all the students here and it will have the grade right here. See that? Not everybody published their grade. Not everybody submitted their assignment, but it will all be right here on this table. Okay, so as the student though, when they go in after they've submitted their assignment and we've posted it back to the student, then they'll be able to pull up their assignment. Oh, somebody went in as me already. Let me try this one. That's totally fine. Okay, so this one was not published. Oh, I'm not going to do a whole nother assignment. But you get the idea. Once they come in as a student, they can pull up their assignment. Did somebody finish theirs completely? No. Okay. All right. So now they've already published it and they cannot redo their assignment anymore. Okay. All right. Questions. I know we went over a little bit. It was so, it took so long for it to get running. Do you have any questions? I sped up at the end to try to give you all the information. Is there any questions you have for me? Grading or?
I just have a question that's not related to anything that you did here, but can you just tell us what you do to use a case study in your class? Like, do you have the students clicking along? Do you put them in teams? How do you do that?
For case studies, there are individual at-home assignments. For example, let me do this one. For example, in my case studies, I'm just going to go into Unit 1, Day 1. the EHRX, the vital signs, so that's like their first day. They go in to vital signs. And I set up, do you see how these seven, there's seven steps up here?
Yeah.
I set up all of the information that's in here, all of it.
But I guess what I'm asking you is if we use a pre-done case study, you usually bring that to class and have, you know, do it as a class project where everybody is in teams and they do it on a computer in the classroom, or how do you do it?
Most of the time we do it as a single assignment. So, for example, our maternity, if you go into SimChart Setup, our maternity group, we'll go into case studies, and then case studies again. What is this? Oh, because it's a playground. Let me go into mine. Hold on. I'll show you. Yes, we do that. We do both. Most of the time, most of our instructors do it as a preparation to come to clinical. So they'll do a case study about, for example, maternity has a case study about the birth itself. Uh-huh. Then the student will do that at home, and then when they go to clinical and they have the birth, they know how to chart. They've kind of figured out all the stuff on the computer already, and they know what to put in when they get back home for their assignment.
Okay.
They do the postpartum hemorrhage one, though. They do in class all together, exactly what you were saying.
Okay.
And they walk them through the case study. Now, remember, these case studies, though, are just are how to chart. So it doesn't have a lot of, like,
okay,
how to deal with it. It's not that kind of a case study. This is all in SimChart. So it's an electronic health record, and it's how to chart. So, okay, for example, on these case studies, I'm sorry, I'm going into my training course, which has everything loaded into it. That one was kind of blank. So if you go into Elsevier content at the very top, do you see that? Elsevier content. And ours use the women's health. So here's women's health. They have unfolding case studies and challenger cases.
Uh-huh.
Click on unfolding case studies, either one. And there's a bunch of case studies that you can use straight off the bat without having to do anything. You can edit them all you want. You can create your own, or you can use them just as they are.
Okay.
So here's, like, for example, what I was saying, postpartum hemorrhage, they do that in class. All you do is click on it, hit copy, because they don't want you to delete the Elsevier one, right? Then you put it into your own course. I'm just going to put it up here, not in my other courses. Hit OK. I'm just going to close that so I can show you where it went. So now, instead of it being in Elsevier content, it's in my cases.
Right.
Under case studies.
Right.
And then the one I just created was, what did I do? Postpartum hemorrhage. I'm like, what did I do? I forgot. The postpartum hemorrhage is, I put it up here in my Elsevier hemorrhage right here. See, it's not published. Sorry, it has my other cases in here that I created. On this one, all you have to do is click on it and do quick publish if you want to just do it as is.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Otherwise, if you open it, you can edit it. You can edit each piece of the entire assignment, whatever you want to edit. And here's those seven steps again.
Right.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So you can go through each step. This is the opening information. This is what the student sees. And you go through each step until you get to step 7.
Right.
So you made sure you did all your charts, all the past information. And in step 7 is where you can publish the assignment. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, I've done all of that. I was just wondering how you used it in the classroom.
Okay. Oh, I'm like trying to go, okay, maybe they want to know a little bit of this. Yes, we do these as pre-work. So they do it at home, case studies, as how I would want them to get ready for clinical. For example, the vital signs one, do that, play with that, know how to chart vital signs, go to clinical, come back, do your assignment. Okay. So, and then maternity does that too through theirs. And then when they do the complex cases, they'll do it in class together.
Okay. I haven't looked at the complex ones.
Okay. All right. I went over time. When you're writing your own case, somebody asked about barcoding. When you get to step 7, it will ask you if you want to turn on barcoding when you're creating it. And you can just simply click yes. So you see how this says FaceTime on or off. You can click whether or not you want barcoding on or off. And then it will allow you to print all the barcode information.
Maddie,
is
your stepdaughter?
Maddie? Yes.
Hi, I got that part. I'm actually okay through all the steps. I've practiced it numerous times.
Right.
I have 2 hiccups.
Yes.
When I try to click on the green light, so as if I were accepting the medication as a student, I've given it.
Right.
Wasn't allowing me to do that. And number 2, what scanner are we using? Because I was able to go in and fill out as if the scanner wasn't working. Mm-hmm. I put all the numbers in there off the medication.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was a line through the green, the little green circle. That's one. And the other thing is, what is the scanner I'm using? We have a scanner on our Pyxis.
Right.
But that's in the med room. The students, it's not on the cart.
So what we did is we just ordered, they're just scanners like grocery stores. Go online, you can order a plug-and-play scanner. You just plug it into your computer and it works.
And I send you the recommendation.
Okay. All right, so we have to order a few of those. And then simply, yeah, it'll figure it out. It'll be plugged in and the system knows.
Usually the scanner themselves, when you just plug in the plug and play ones, it just automatically work. Okay. But I mean, you never know when it comes to IT stuff.
The other issue then is, I think Tara said I needed to be in student mode.
Yes, practice it. Mm-hmm.
I was in instructor mode.
No, you want to, so to add bar scanning, you're in instructor mode. Once you save the assignment, then you go into student mode to double check if it worked.
Okay, I see that.
Yeah.
As if I was the student going in, I checked the ID, so I scanned the ID and it clicked. Then I checked the med and it accepted it, turned green.
Right.
Then I can't do that as an instructor. I can only do it as a student.
Exactly, okay. Yeah.
All right, I'll practice that some more.
Okay.
Just have to purchase a couple of scanners.
Oh, perfect. So the problem we had when they didn't work is because I didn't have rights to add a program to my computer. So I'd have IT do it. Just okay. So you know. Yeah.
Okay, super.
Hey.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Maddie.
Thanks, Maddie.
You're welcome. Oh, yeah. Bye-bye.
Oh, good.